Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America. Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America. Thank you. Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America. Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America. Thank you. Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget that. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tom Tillis, Senator from the great state of North Carolina. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and to secure the blessings of liberty. This 4th of July, let's remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years as a country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who have endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It's also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we are all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July.
Thank you for being here today. You have made our day. We've been looking forward to this for about a month now, planning. And I want to thank my wife and everybody that's worked with us to get everything together. And I'm glad the flag's still flying.
Right. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You don't love it, leave it the way I feel.
Amen.
We're real conservative, King James Bible. We're patriotic. And I voted for Trump. But besides that, let me just say, we do need to have a word of prayer today. All right. Brother Keith Thomas, would you ask the Lord to bless the service today? Let's all stand, and we're going to pledge allegiance to the American flag. Attention, salute. Attention, salute, pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Remain standing while they sing the national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleam, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in through the night, that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free,
seated. The choir's going to sing today. Come on in, Travis. And we're glad to have all these men and ladies with us today and giving their lives in military or civil service that we could be here today. And I thank the Lord for that. I'm proud to say I've had people in my family from the Revolutionary War and every war that we could be right here today. America's is free because God sets men free. Bill Bennett said the best way you could tell if a nation was great is open its gates. And which way they run will tell you which way the country's great. People do not run from America. They're trying to run into America. Only thing they ought to do it legally. All right? All right. I got my little preaching in. Aren't you? Be seated while the choir sings.
In this modern new world we live in today, blood-bought believers are thought of as strange. They say we're living our lives in the past, and without change or compromise, we will not last. Oh, but we're set apart from the world and its way. I gave up that old life the day I was saved.
I'll take the old time way. There's not one thing I've changed. I've come this morning with him.
keep pressing on for the Lord and the right. Though the battle is raging, don't you give up that fight. For now is the time, this is the place, to stand here as one and boldly proclaim,
I'll take the old time way. There's not one thing I change. I've done this for him. With him I'll go all the way. I'll not back down. I'll not give in. I've read the last chapter. I know who wins. I'll run the last mile of the race in the old time way.
We must stand strong.
Work with
Well, we had to put up with that old singing like that every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday. I like the old time way, don't you? I'm an American from the top of my head to the sole of my foot. I love America. I'm glad the flag's still waving. It's been through battles, beaten and burned, but I'm glad she's still waving today. I love my country. I really do. Well, let me just say we're so glad for all these people that's been invited, all the military men and women, service men and women. We're glad that you took time. I know you didn't have to do it, and I want you to. I'm glad that you came, and we're going to go through the rest of the service, and then at the end of the service, we have a meal for everybody. In fact, Ms. Connie said they couldn't hardly have enough tables to put the food on. And our fellowship hall is just 110 feet long, so you can imagine how much food's up there. So we want everybody to stay and partake of that good meal. All right, what kind of church is this? What do Baptists do? They have to take an offering. All right, let's stand while the ushers come, and we'll receive an offering. We'll lift an offering. We'll take it. We've got enough guns around here. We can take an offering. But anyway, no, but you don't have to give. Just anybody that will. Tithes and offerings belong to your local church, not here. All right. Yes. I just ask Brother Wayne if he'll ask the Lord to bless the offering today. All right, just remain standing. Sean's going to come and lead us in My Country Tis Thee. Everybody knows.
Oh, yeah, page 438 if you need a book.
My country tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. There my fathers died, land of the pilgrim pride, from every mountainside let freedom ring.
Let's sing the last verse.
Our Father's God to thee, author of liberty, to thee we sing. Long may our land be bright with freedom's holy light. Protect us by the might, great God our King.
All right, you may be seated while the trio comes and sings for us at this time. And thank God for the First Amendment, for the Second Amendment. Thomas Jefferson, one of my heroes, I think he's probably the most intelligent man this country's ever had. And he was visiting a little Baptist church close to his home. And he invited the Baptist preacher to come in, just a little old Baptist church. And he ate lunch with Thomas Jefferson. And Mr. Jefferson said, "Sir?" The preacher said, "Mr. Jefferson, what do you think of our little Baptist church?" He said, "The one kind of government this country should be built upon." And I'm glad we had the foundation right. Thank God. And don't let anybody tell you that our forefathers weren't fearful of God and believers in God. Thomas Jefferson wrote a book on the ethics of God. They went and titled it Thomas Jefferson Book, Bible. But it wasn't a Bible, just excerpts where he proved the ethical standards of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, pray for this trio. I've been known about 30 years now. They're pretty good.
Some will say it's foolish, some that it's absurd, but still we choose to build our lives upon God's holy word. We know it's always perfect, we trust it in all things, it's holy and it's right, so whatever this life brings,
stand on what is timeless. We stand on what is true. We stand up unashamed, no matter what the world may do. We stand upon this rock, spoken by the Lord of all, and no other lies built on sand may fall. We stand.
It may not be in fashion, it may not be in vogue, but when we look at empty lives all around, we know we could live pursuing power, thinking pleasure satisfies. God's light shines through the shadows, revealing their just lies.
We stand on what is timeless. We stand on what is true. We stand up unashamed, no matter what the world may do. We stand upon this rock, spoken by the Lord of all, and no other lives built on sand may fall. We stand.
Let us trust His every word,
resisting every wrong. Let us read it and believe it. It's our only hope, our standing strong. We stand on what is timeless. We stand on what is true. We stand up unashamed, no matter what the world may do. We stand upon this rock, spoken by the Lord of all, and no other lives built on sand may fall. We stand. We stand.
This is my pretty wife. She said, you've been knowing her only more than 30 years. Yesterday was our 56th anniversary. I don't know if we're going to make it to 57 or not. I'll just be honest with you. A man's got to decide if he's going to be right or happy. I'm never right, so I decide to be happy, all right? We're going to ask some men from the church, if you'll come first, Hill, and then Brother Coltonette. You'll be second, and then Brother Teach will wind up. So you're first, right, or are you going to be last? You're going to be last. Sit right there. Come on up here.
Yes, sir.
You can tell they listen to what I preach, don't you? Where's Colton at? Come on up, Colton. And his brother, he'll teach you. And then Brother Colton's going to talk to us a little bit about Brother John Locke and, you know, what he did for this country. Okay, Brother Hill.
Preacher asked me to just say a couple of words about my life and how the Army affected me and my faith and my beliefs. I am the son of a preaching daddy and a praying mama. I had rough relationships with Dad growing up. It started getting bad when I was probably 12 or 13, and by the time I was 18 years old, I knew everything, and he knew nothing. When I turned 18, I was sick to death of being told what to do, where to go, when to go, and all that. So I left home and joined the Army. Two years later, when I got out of the Army, I can't honestly tell you that the Army had done anything good for me, but it had made Dad a lot smarter because now he was saying things that made sense. he was saying things like, get up early, work hard, vote. If you have to ask for a raise, you probably don't deserve it. Go to church. You know, it took me a lot of years, even after the Army, it took me a lot of years to get that last part right. But between my parents and the time that I spent in the service, I'm pretty happy with the way my life has turned out. And I think the recipe of godly parents and some good old Uncle Sam discipline would go a long way towards solving some of the problems that we have in this world.
Glad to have Brother Colton. He's going to come and tell us a little about, if you see a flag out there in the vestibule, it says appeal to heaven. He's going to give you a little story behind what all that means.
Morning. The flag, An Appeal to Heaven, sometimes known as the John Locke flag, is a take on John Locke's book, The Second Treatise on Civil Government, coming from the quote in chapter 14, where the body of the people or any single man is deprived of their right or is under excessive power without any right and have no appeal on earth. They have liberty to appeal to heaven whenever they judge the cause of that significant moment. This quote is part of Locke's justification for the overthrowing of the British king at the time in 1688, known as the Glorious Revolution. Locke's appeal to heaven wasn't necessarily about prayer, but a call to action. Locke argued that people have rights from God that cannot be infringed upon by the government, and that rebellion is a justification to defend those rights. As the American colonists increasingly came under conflict with the British government during the 1760s and the 1770s, Locke's words became an inspiration to many patriots. After all, if Britain's glorious revolution was justified as a defense against tyranny, didn't the American Revolution have the same justification? The design of the flag came from General Washington's secretary, Colonel Joseph Reed, in a letter dated October 21st, 1775. Reed suggested that a flag with a white crown and a tree in the middle with the motto from Locke, An Appeal to Heaven, be used for the ships of Washington's commissioned navy at the time. After the founding fathers went through all channels and debated with the British crown, their voices were not heard. The only option left was this movement of rebellion. In today's terms, most of our founding fathers would be considered terrorists, radicals, or troublemakers. Today, we should, as a free people, watch the powers of the central government and the consolidation of the federal at the federal level, and be concerned to us all. The fundamental value of freedom, the belief that liberty is something that is divinely given from God, should always be held first in our country. We are citizens, not subjects. And if we are to remain free, we must be one nation under God.
Amen. Now this man is real old. He's been on a poster for about 50 years, I guess, or so, saying, I want you. This is Brother Claude Shealy, alias Uncle Sam.
I'd like to first of all say I'm nervous. I'm not used to speaking in public, but the only thing I can say is, I want you. And most of you here are too young to have experienced that. But I'm glad God saved me. As you get older, you look back on life and you can reflect on things and how God has brought you out. When I joined the Navy in 1965, and for the first couple of years, I served aboard a communication command ship, converted carrier, the USS Wright. And in 1967, I was fortunate enough to have served and been called aboard the battleship New Jersey. One of the last battleships of Iowa they put in commission after we were, but that was some good duty. But to tell you how God protects you, one of my jobs was on the stern. I was in the number 3 turret, and we passed powder up to shoot the shell, which weighed 2,700 pounds. That's a big old bullet, 6 foot tall. took 6 bags of powder, 110 pounds, to shoot one time, and had 3 barrels on each turret. So when those things went off, all 3 barrels, I had to send up 18 bags of powder. Well, on that powder, it had a red ignition end that was highly flammable. If you saw a tear or a hole, you had to stop everything. They stopped everything on the ship till you got that up. And we fired one night and a day for 36 straight hours and emptied out the bottom magazine, and we had to move up to the top magazine. Well, to get the powder, everything went through the bottom magazine. They had a trolley that'd come up, and I'd push the powder on that trolley, and they'd send it down. They'd put it up there and put it in the barrel. Boom, it'd go off. Well, we were firing so fast that before that trolley would get there, I'd push that powder off. It's about that long, about that big a rim. I'd push it off to hit that trolley and give it about a 2-foot start before it hit that trolley. Well, they were firing so fast that I'd push it before the trolley got there, and lo and behold, the trolley cable had broken. And when I pushed that powder off, that trolley went down and the powder turned ignition end down and hit the floor, and it should have exploded. At that time, I didn't know why, but as I got older, I can look back and see how God had his hand on that. We stopped everything. But many times, through many things, I've been shot, stabbed, cut, and everything else, but I can see how God has had his protective hand on me, and I thank God for that, and I thank God for the privilege to have served in service. It's amazing, you look around, how few people served, and I count it as a privilege to have given 4 years of my life for this country. I love it. Thank you.
Thank you. Give a big hand for each of these men. Well, we got some that'll fight here. I'm going to ask Stafford Hamilton if you'll come up here. Are you going to speak about this man that lost his life?
Okay. All right. Glad to have you. Hey, my name is Stafford Hamilton. I'm a master police officer with the Concord Police Department. I've been here approximately 8 years. I'm currently on this on patrol and also on the SWAT team. And first of all, on behalf of the Concord Police Department, I just want to say how appreciative we are of all y'all support that you provide. Everybody knows that this day and age, everything going on politically doesn't make our job easier.
That's right.
But with all y'all's support, it helps us along. And especially after what I can say is the worst day in Concord Police Department history, December 16th, 2020. Everybody knows what happened that day, and just the amount of support that we saw the following days after that, it was amazing. Almost every street in Concord shut down for what happened. And then just the procession that lasted all the way from the arena to almost Rowan County, it was just seeing the people lined on the streets, it was nothing I've ever seen before, and it was amazing, and we just really appreciate y'all's support. All right.
Thank you. These men are on, the ladies are on call, so they get up and go out. It's not because they don't like you. They're going to go try to help somebody. Isn't that a blessing that they take their time to come like this? All right. Is the Marine recruiter here? Oh, okay, he didn't come. Okay, well, I want to make sure about that. Okay. All right. Out in the vestibule, we've got a big monitor. And Tom Tillis, if you go out there, he's a senator from North Carolina. And he had a message that he's doing live, audio. And here it is. I'll just read it to you. Hi, I'm Tom Tillis. No, I'm not. Happy Independence Day. 245 years ago, the Founding Fathers set out to form a more perfect union, to establish justice, to ensure domestic tranquility, to provide for the common defense, to promote the general welfare, and secure the blessings of liberty. Did he plagiarize it? Okay. This 4th of July, let us remember the freedoms and liberties we get to enjoy every day just by simply living in the United States. Throughout our more than 240 years of the country, our nation has shown its strength and its resilience in the toughest times, and this year is no different. America is great because of the great citizen servants who endeavored to achieve that goal of forming a more perfect union. It is also because of the bravery of our service members and veterans that we're all able to gather with our family and friends on this 4th of July. As a nation, we must never forget. I wish you and your family a safe and happy 4th of July. God bless you, and God bless the United States of America. And I appreciate Brother Tillis sending that message, and you can go out there and listen to it on the monitor if you want to, okay? We've had several, 29, 30 different people came in different branches and civil services. So one man that I really like, Brother Jason Williams. Brother Jason, you come. And Brother Jason Williams is a graduate of our Bible college. We have Macedonia Baptist College. And he paid me $100, and I gave it, no. But Brother, he has gone on. God has used this young man. Right now, he's the executive director at the North Carolina Faith and Freedom Coalition. And Brother Jason, thank you so much for coming.
Appreciate you. Thank you. Well, man, it sure is good to be here this morning. You know, the other day when Brother Ronnie called, he said, I want you to come. We're having the service. He said, just take about 10 minutes and share with us what's on your heart. And I thought, man, you know what? I've been coming here for over 20 years. And I remember one of the first dates I brought my girlfriend on. We're sitting back there, and we listened to Sammy Allen for about what seemed to be 7 or 8 hours. And you're telling me I've got 10 minutes?
I'm telling you, you've got 10 minutes.
Unbelievable. I mean, they would keep me hostage in this room for hours. And he calls me and says, I want you to come for 10 minutes. That is absolutely unbelievable. $100 don't go near as far as it used to. That is just unreal. Well, man, it sure is good to be here. I appreciate the opportunity to come and just be a part of this service. And I do. I love our country. I love America. I'm proud to be an American. I'm not ashamed of that. You know, look around. We've got our flaws. We've got our problems. But there's nowhere in the world I'd rather be today than here in the United States of America. And I love it. And God convicted my heart and burdened us to work and do things here in North Carolina to work for our state, on behalf of our state and our country. But you know, I'll talk just a little bit, and I'll keep it to somewhere around 10 minutes to an hour. And so just want to share with you something's on my heart. Just want to share with you a little bit about my testimony and just talk about our country and really how appreciative I am. I don't know. The one thing I thought was interesting, was that a real call, or was that like the police-fireman rivalry thing? Did we see firsthand? Right here, like, did we just see that play out right here? Like, you got up and spoke, and they're like, bam, we're out of here. So that was good. But, I grew up, I'm from Gaston County, I grew up on what you would consider to be the wrong side of the tracks. I mean, we grew up, we were very poor. You know, my mom, she left my dad before I was born. They were in Knoxville, Tennessee, and my mom moved down here, and to Gastonia. She had no marketable skills. She didn't have an education. I think she had a third or fourth grade education. And we lived off the government our whole lives. We were very poor. And I remember as an 8-year-old boy, we were homeless living at Salvation Army in Gastonia. And I remember walking to school down the road to Wood Hill Elementary School. And I just remember thinking, there's got to be more to life than what I'm getting out of it. There's got to be more to life than this. And a couple years later, my mom was looking through the phone book, and she would call churches to see if they would help us out paying the bills and do different things. And I remember we stopped at a phone booth, and she found a gospel tract in a phone booth, and she called the church and said, hey, would you help me with whatever it is she needed help with that particular month? And he said, yeah, come on to the church. We'll help you out. We'd love to be a part of that. And so Sunday night, we went to the church, and he did, and he said, I want you to I wanted your boys, talking about me and my younger brother. I was 12, he was 10. He said, I want your boys to go to the youth camp with us later on this summer. It was in a couple of weeks. And I had no desire to go. I was 12 years old, and I didn't really have a church background and didn't really care about any of that stuff. And I had plans for the summer that didn't involve a church youth camp. And so my mom was like, no, they paid the bills. They did this. You're going to this youth camp. I mean, she sent us out, man. It's the cost of admission, I guess. And so so we went. My brother and I go to this youth camp. And again, I had no desire to go, didn't really care. And we go up to West Jefferson, Light on the Mountain Youth Camp. It was in 1995 in August. And Pastor Terry Dietz was preaching that week. And man, it seemed like Terry Dietz got up on Tuesday night of that youth camp. And God, it seemed like he'd been listening to Sammy Allen because he preached an hour and a half. It was like literally one of the longest messages. And you got the sawdust, you got all this stuff. And it was just horrible. Like life was horrible up there at this place. And it was hot. I mean, it's August. It's, oh my gosh. Anyway, I didn't plan to say all that, but it was bad. Anyway, it's Tuesday night at youth camp. And I remember after Brother Dietz got done, he gave an invitation. And another young man from Gaston County went down. He was 19 years old. And he answered the call to preach that night. His name's Jesse Haley. And Jesse answered the call to preach that night. And John Melton, the moderator of the camp, he got up. And he said with his just, you know, hillbilly, redneck, gruff voice, said, well, Jesse, if God called you to preach, you ought to get up here and preach right now. And I thought, what? We just, what? And Jesse did. He gets his Bible, he opens it up, he walks up there, and he starts preaching. And I'm sitting there thinking, man, what have I gotten into? You know, whatever bill this church paid was not worth this. I don't know what they did, but this is unbelievable. But I'm going to tell you something. He got done preaching that night, August the 8th, 1995, and God convicted my heart. And he showed me I was lost. And I remember that night as clear as day. I remember the Holy Spirit saying, there's more to life than what you're getting out of it. There's more to it than what you're seeing. And that night, as a 12-year-old boy, I accepted Christ, got gloriously saved, got born again that night, came back, and of course, Jesse became my best friend, and ended up graduating. We got married, and what I'm saying is, what I want to get to is, on my 30th birthday, you know, God had burdened me to be involved more politically as I got older. And I ran for county commissioner there in Gaston County. And on my 30th birthday, I was elected as the youngest county commissioner ever in the history of Gaston County. And so when I was elected county commissioner, I would oftentimes, we'd go to Washington, D.C. a couple times a year. And I remember I would always love to go to the National Archives. I mean, again, I never got to go younger. I mean, we never got to go to these trips. And I would always go to the National Archives, and I loved seeing all of our founding documents. I loved seeing the Constitution. I loved seeing the Magna Carta. All this other stuff that was there was just, it was absolutely amazing to me. But I'm going to tell you, something that always amazed me the most was when you would get to the Declaration of Independence. And it would just take your breath away when you would sit or stand and look at this, and you would think about these courageous men who signed this document knowing if they were to get caught that they would undoubtedly be killed. And what that document did was, for the first time in history, it didn't matter what your background was, it didn't matter who your family was, it didn't matter what zip code you came from, but you would be successful or you would fail, but you'd have the liberty and freedom to do what you wanted to do. Amen. For the first time ever, that didn't just change the United States. That changed the world. That changed everything with that particular document. And you say, well, man, not everybody was free at that time. You're exactly right. But it was those words, the words that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. And they're endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It was those words that led to the abolition of slavery. It was those words that led to women's suffrage, and it led to the civil rights movements. Without that document, none of this other stuff happens. And I would just think that's just absolutely amazing to see that and just appreciate and take it in every time I went to Washington, D.C. But for me, I remember thinking on so many occasions, I thought for me, what this meant was something even more personal than that. I would read it and I would think about it, and I would look back at other countries and other people, and I would think what this meant was, you would take this young man who was poor, homeless, had really nothing to offer, and that God could use his life. He'd grow up, he'd get married, have kids, and on his 30th birthday, that guy could be elected county commissioner in Gaston County. Guys, what that Declaration of Independence means, it meant something for the world. It meant something for the country. But because of that document, it meant something to you. It meant that's the reason we're here today. 245 years ago, today, those men signed that document, giving us the liberty and the freedom to be here today. And I want you to point something out. The whole thing about freedom, you know, we act like that's just the normal thing. Do you realize freedom is not just a human characteristic? It's not. Freedom is a virtue. Freedom's not, as a matter of fact, I'll prove it to you. You remember back in the book of Exodus when the children of Israel left Egypt and they were finally free and they escaped bondage. Do you remember what they said? You know, do you remember, did they get out and say, man, it's good to be free. We're finally out of that place. We're finally out of bondage. No. You know what they said? They said, would to God we were back in Egypt, where at least we had meat to eat. The human characteristic, the human trait is to be taken care of. There's no wonder that you've got a whole party right now that's going socialist, that's promoting socialism, because people want to be taken care of. It's virtuous to yearn for freedom, and that's what these people did. They wanted to be free. And ladies and gentlemen, we enjoy our freedom today because of what they did. But I want to tell you something. If you care at all about your kids and your grandkids, and my wife and I, we have six kids at home. They're all young kids. If you care about your kids, grandkids, and great-grandkids, you're going to have to fight for that today. We enjoy it because of what they did. They're going to enjoy it based off the decisions we make in 2021. And I'll close with this. I want you guys to know here on the front row, I want you to know we appreciate you. And I know you go through a lot. I know you do a lot. But I want you to know, on behalf of the good folks here, we appreciate you. And I know Brother Ronnie will talk to you a little bit here in a minute. But, you know, there's a Baptist church on the side of the road that cares about you and that appreciates you and that honors you for what you're doing. And we're very grateful for the hard work and everything you're doing. You know, I'll finish with this. I've not gone nearly long enough, but I'll close anyway. You know, in my trips to Washington, I may have shared this before. In my trips to Washington, I would always make it a point to when we'd fly in, I always wanted to look out at the monuments. Loved it. I mean, just looking at those monuments. If you've flown into Washington, I'm sure many of you have, and when you can see the Washington Monument and the Capitol and the Jefferson Memorial and Lincoln Memorial, you see all this as you're flying up. I mean, just a breathtaking sight. It's just so amazing. And I remember I would always want to sit in a position to where I could see that as we're taking off. And I remember one time, I didn't get that same opportunity. I sat in a seat that was on the other side, and I just didn't get that same view. And as we're taking off, as we're leaving Reagan National Airport, I remember I didn't look out and see those same monuments. You know, I would oftentimes think to myself when I saw that, I would oftentimes think, man, how great would it be to have somebody like a Thomas Jefferson today? How great would it be to have a George Washington today? How great to have, you know, Abraham Lincoln, any of those great men that God had raised up for such a time that they were in. We need those men. Oh, God, give us some of those men. I would think that all the time. But this other time, when I was on this other side of the plane, we took off, and I remember looking out, and I didn't see all those same things. I saw acre after acre of just this grass lot with thousands of headstones. And it was very different. And I remember thinking to myself, you know what? What those guys did, what George Washington did, what Abraham Lincoln did, what Thomas Jefferson did, what they did for us was phenomenal. And the courage that they had was just amazing. And I appreciate it. But do you know what I realized at that time? When I looked at the thousands of headstones as we were flying up, those were the people that really built this country. And do you know what we need right now? It would be great if we had some of the old preachers of yesteryear. You know, oh God, give us a Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Lord, send us another Billy Sunday or Harold Tytler or another Sammy Allen. God, we need people like that. But do you know what we really need right now? We need some men, women, boys, and girls who will stand up. We need some people that will say, we've had enough. Enough is enough. And we're no longer going to sit by, idly by in our country, and watch them try to take away our liberty. We're not going to sit by. We're not going to tell them that they can have all this other stuff. We're not going to let them take away our Second Amendment. We're not going to let them take away our support of Israel. We're not going to sit idly by while they defund our police. We're not going to sit idly by while they disrespect our flag. We're not going to sit idly by while they try to take away our support of Israel or our Second Amendment or the sanctity of life or the sanctity of marriage. We're not going to sit idly by. Enough is enough. And ladies and gentlemen, it's going to come up to people like me and you and the people here at Bright Light Baptist Church that if we're not going to stand up and do it, if you're not going to stand with us and stand together and do it, ladies and gentlemen, our kids and grandkids will not enjoy this 245 years from now, what you've been able to enjoy and prosper, what we've been able to have right now. So what I would say to you is today's the day you've got to make the commitment that we're going to stand together. We're not going to allow these crazy leftists that hate our country. They want to fundamentally change our country. We're not going to sit by and let it happen. So I would ask you, stand with us. I appreciate you letting me be here. And guys, thank you for what you're doing. And I love our country. Appreciate it, brother.
Thank you, Brother Jason. Give him a big one. All right, Brother Wayne.
You ready? You ready? All right, we want all that. Did all of you come back? Were there about six? Huh? Okay, all right. We have something for everybody, so whoever's in charge, make sure you see me or somebody.
Oh, you got it? Okay. All right. I won't. I'll hear about it. All right. Military service is just kind of on the forward. And also, too, Brother Wayne.
Jeff Luck, Conquer Fire Department, 16 years. Thank y'all.
My name's Caleb Schreckengass. I'm a... proud to be an American. Tech sergeant in the U.S. Air Force, working on 10 years now, and I'm proud of it. It's been one of the best things in my life, and I'm here with my beautiful wife, and one thing I don't think gets talked about enough. Is the spouses of all these guys. As much as we do, they do more at home. When we're gone, they take care of the home. So thanks for having us here, and we appreciate it. Thanks to Richie and his family for inviting us, and thank y'all.
Hey, how's it going? Logan Carter. I serve as an officer with the Mooresville Police Department, and I just want to thank my family, Buster and Travis, for inviting me, and thanks for having us. Thank you.
Stafford Hamilton again. I just want to reiterate how appreciative we are of all y'all's support. It makes our job easier every day. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Colton Haynes. I served 10 years on Guard and active duty status with the Army National Guard and Third Army Group. I got back from a rotation overseas in 2020. That was Operation Spartan Shield that we partook in. It's just a defensive operation in the Middle East to deter Iran. I served as a sergeant. I just recently got out back in March, and glad my wife had put up with everything that over the 15, 16 months that I was gone, she definitely was the rock in our marriage, so appreciate her.
Joe Rushing, I'm part of this Simpson clan. I was in during the Vietnam thing. I didn't go to Vietnam, but we did a lot of burial details from the guys that died over there. And it's great to be here. Thank you.
Specialist Bogus, I was in the Army for 8 years, from 2006 to 2014, did two tours to Iraq. Now I'm currently a correctional officer at Albemarle Correctional Institute.
Name's Jeremy Clark, police officer with Albemarle Police Department down the road here. I just want to thank the Lord for keeping me safe for 23 years so far, and I trust in Him that He's going to keep me safe the rest of the journey.
Thank you. Hey, John Hall. I served in the Marine Corps, 92 to 96. I want to thank the Robert and Darlene Johnson and the Websters for talking me into coming. I've enjoyed it. I really needed to hear that message. Yeah, thank you for that. I thank the Lord I heard that. But I did a lot of things, seen a lot of bad things, seen some good things. But every day was a holiday, and every meal was a feast.
Jason Cook, I'm Captain Rescue 3. I've been with Concord about 15 years.
Philip Burris, Lieutenant for Rescue 3, Concord Fire Department. I've been there 18 years now.
Thank you, sir.
Jake Ingles, Rescue 3, firefighter on the back. Been here for about 4 years.
I'm Jeff Crane, firefighter on Rescue 3. Been with here just a couple of years here. We thank you for your support and your prayers.
My name is Carlos Villanueva. I'm a master medic with Cabarrus County EMS and a community paramedic. I've been with Cabarrus County for about 27 years as a paramedic and been a paramedic for about 29 years.
My name is Paul Robertson. I served in the United States Marine Corps from 1989 to 1993 with 3rd Battalion, 6th Marine, 2nd Marine Division. I'm currently serving in with the Bravo Company 1/120th Infantry Regiment, the 30th Armored Brigade Combat Team, North Carolina National Guard. All right.
My name is Summer Boysworth. Been a paramedic here at Cabarrus County for about 4 years. Been a medic now for about 6, and in EMS for 8 years.
I'm Leah Barkley. I'm a paramedic with Cabarrus County and Stanley County EMS, and I've been in the service for about 2 years now.
Renee Soriano, engineer on Concord Rescue 3. Been here about 9.5 years. Thank you for having us.
I'm Travis Giddings. I'm a paramedic. I work with Cabarrus EMS. Work for Roanne as well. I've been doing it for about 5 years now.
Claude Chigley, served from 65 to 69 in the U.S. Navy.
I'm Hill Tichy. I was in the 18th Airborne Corps of the U.S. Army from 1974 to 1976.
I'm Barry Paget. I was in the Army from 1982 to 1984. Had a great time. I wouldn't do it again, but I loved it.
Thank you, Brother Barry.
These men and ladies need a big round of applause. I mean, I'm telling you from the bottom of my heart, I cannot thank you how much it means. to me to see you give yourselves to our country. It means a whole lot to us. You can be seated for just about an hour and a half till they get to midnight. All right, we got it warmed up. I've asked our folks if they'd bring somebody, I'd do something for them, all right? If you brought somebody, tell me how many you brought. How many brought 100? Stand up. 20. 22. Come on, Sean. All right. 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12. Come on down. Give him a big hand. He was playing football last night and separated his shoulder. I tell you, those old bones don't take it like they used to. All right, what we get down to? 10? 12? How many brought 11? Anybody bring 11? Thank you. I wonder if I can count backwards. 10? You're getting close to me. Somebody bring 10? 9? 8? Come on, Brother Richie. Hey, Brother Richie. That's a blessing, Brother Richie. Good to see you. 7, 6, 5. Come on down, brother. All right, that's fine. We'll take care of both of you. We'll take care of Miss Teachy. All right, you brought 5? All right, I'm going to give this to him. We'll get you two taken care of tonight. Oh, not tonight. Don't come back to church tonight. You brought 5? All right, we'll take care of Jim. Okay, and let's see. All right. And you brought 5. All right, friends, write these people down. Write their names down. I can't. Sean, stand up here and help me now. See, where was she? Yeah, Jim Hudson. Miss Mann, all right. I saw you, I can't see. Anybody on this side else? And Miss Teachy. And Darlene. One more. It seemed like there was one more. Okay. We'll take care of you by Wednesday night or something like that. We do not have service tonight. And all the Baptists said, hallelujah, glory to God. Don't have to put that preacher no more. But I can't tell you how much I appreciate you being here. And just pray for us. We're trying to build a church, trying to do right, trying to hold up the old standards, Bible, King James, trying to live right. And these men and ladies here are the reason that we're able to come today. And I thank you so, so very much. All right, Sean is in charge of our getting us up here to the food. Now, you can stay as long as you want to, but the rest of us are going to leave at 2 o'clock, all right? Now, I want you to stay as long as you can. I hope you, just eat and eat. And you know, we used to just pull down the sheets and eat like a hog. And, you know, we got chicken and dumplings. We've got banana pudding. We got German chocolate cake. We got 8-layer chocolate cake, and you that are listening in the fellowship hall, that was my order, so it takes you. All right, let's all stand, and no, you stay sitting, but I'm afraid we'll have a rush. Come on, Sean, tell us what to do.
All right, what we're going to do is we're going to ask that all of our front row, our military, law enforcement, fire, all of our veterans, all of those guys, visitors, man, we appreciate you.
And their families.
And their families. I didn't walk up there a while ago, but I'm 14 years. I run the Idlewild Fire Department for 14 years, and so my blood bleeds what you guys are, man. I appreciate you guys. I really do. But I ask all of you guys, if you will, we're going to walk out this door right here where Brother Calvin's standing. He'll direct you around to the parking lot. We'll go out the main door, and Calvin, just make sure they're going to walk around to the outside. We're going to enter the fellowship hall on that first set of doors that we're going to come to in the center of the fellowship building, okay?
Let's ask the blessing before we start. Dear Lord, bless this food. Amen.
That was it. So all you guys and your families, we're going to let you go first, and then I'll dismiss the rest of you just after these guys get out. So you guys can leave out.
There'll be no takeouts, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Now, listen. Thank you, preacher. Well, let's let our visitors go and eat and enjoy, but we're not going to take out a bunch of takeout plates, Sherman.
Don't eat all the banana pudding. That's burning.
Hey, also, after we eat, as long as Concord Fire is still here, they got two trucks outside so the children can go look at them. Adults can go look at them too if they want to. All right, now we want all of our seniors can be dismissed, and we'll go out the same direction. Okay, we'll just walk around the building. That way we can get you in and out hopefully pretty quick. Richie, that's the seniors, not you.
Darlene.
My goodness. Man don't even show up half the time, and now he wants to take over.
Francis.
All right. Now the rest of you can be dismissed. Okay. Yes. Those other visitors here, make sure our visitors are in line ahead of us, okay? So all of the Bright Light members, be courteous to let them visitors go first. Okay? You should have. Why are you doing still in here? I called you twice, military and then old retired.